Speed. It seems to govern every aspect of our lives nowadays, from the way that we travel, to the way we get our entertainment, and even the way that we receive information over the internet, like this video. But speed was as important during the era of the great ocean liners as it is today. In fact, it was speed that even drove the development of ocean liners in the first place. Luxury and spaciousness were nice, but speed was king, and in the annals of the great fast ocean liners, one name stands head and shoulders above the rest. That name? SS United States. But just how do you get a machine almost 1,000 feet long, displacing 45,000 tons of water, up to speeds in excess of 38 knots? That's 70 kilometers per hour, or 43 miles per hour. It took some good old-fashioned engineering know-how and a lot of problem-solving. Here is why the SS United States was so fast. Our story begins in the post-war world, when America's production capacity was at an all-time high, and the nation sought to compete against the giant liners of Europe, like Queen Mary, Queen Elizabeth, and France's Liberté. America's answer to this was the SS United States. A ship that was not luxurious in the traditional sense, but was stylish in a madman kind of way. Most importantly of all, though, she was quick. Speed was her very essence. It was in her DNA. The US government underwrote about two-thirds of the ship's construction costs, around $50 million of $78 million, and subsidized her operations in the hope that she would be used as a troop ship in the event of a war with the Soviet Union. This is because the United States Navy had been very impressed by the performance of Cunard's Queens during the Second World War. Of course, until that point, Queen Mary had been the reigning blue ribbon holder for almost 15 years. Now it was America's turn. But wait, before we go any further, I need to introduce you to somebody. This is William Francis Gibbs, one of my favourite characters of maritime history of all time. He had set out initially as a young man to become a lawyer, but quickly found himself drawn to ships and naval architecture. His college dorm room ended up covered with rolled up plans of battleships and ocean liners. He practiced law for 2 years, but began designing, with his brother Frederick, a 1,000-foot-long ocean liner, and in 1915 he left law for good. What followed was a stellar career, and the Gibbs name is attached to some of history's greatest liners, from the Leviathan to the beautiful Matson liners of the 1930s. He was a total eccentric, stern and cool, and he watched over the construction of his ships like a hawk. He was obsessive, agonizing over every detail, and taking lessons from ships that had come and gone before. From Titanic, he drew lessons about compartmentalization, and in typical Gibbs fashion, he took it to the next level. His ships were the safest afloat. In 1927, the SS Malolo was on her sea trials when she was heavily rammed by a freighter. The collision opened up Malolo's hull and 7,000 tons of water poured in. Any other ship would probably have sunk, except Malolo was designed by Gibbs, and she stayed afloat. He was even on board that day to watch the whole thing unfold. So Gibbs turned his eye to the design of a great American blue ribbon winning ship. But in order to pull it off, he had a couple of problems to solve. One, to design the most efficient hull form possible, and two, to outfit it with the most powerful engines afloat. Easy peasy. First up, the hull design. Gibbs and his team would have to come up with something radical if the ship was going to break speed records. To do it, as always, he'd borrow a little bit from ships from the past. In overview, it's pretty clear that the SS United States proportions are extremely lean. The ship has a long, elegant profile and relatively little superstructure above the hull. She was 990 feet in length, with a beam of about 101 feet and a draft of 31 feet. Her hull was divided into 20 watertight compartments, with fuel and ballast tanks extending up the sides of the hull to create a second skin. This was classic Gibbs over-designing. The ship would remain afloat with as many as 5 of these compartments flooded, and one additional safety measure gave away her naval pedigree. The ship, actually featured two separated engine rooms, a practice commonly found on warships at the time, so that in the event of a torpedo strike or shell hit, the ship could move under her own power if one of those engine rooms was knocked out. But going back to the hull shape, what's so special about it in the first place? To understand this, we have to turn the pages back in our history book a couple of years. The revolutionary German liners Bremen and Europa had created an absolute sensation when they stole the blue ribbon from the old Mauritania in 1929 and 1930. Gibbs had paid close attention to their hull form and general proportion, stating that there was this remarkable agreement in length and beam. Gibbs had also learned a lot from when he was the chief designer on the construction of SS America before the war, chief among which was the ship's shape below the waterline. The ship had a low prismatic coefficient, with narrow, tapered ends, and a wider midsection prioritising speed for stability. The higher the prismatic coefficient on a ship, the blockier and less efficient it is while cutting through the water, and Gibbs decided to give United States an extremely low coefficient of 0.559, with an even narrower bow and stern than America. From the German superliners Bremen and Europa, Gibbs borrowed a very slight bulbous bow to reduce drag as the ship ploughed through the waves. For this reason too, her prow was heavily raked forward. On the SS America, the prow had raked before dropping vertical at the waterline and below, which created drag and slowed the ship down. The United States bow would be raked all the way down. Even to a casual observer, the aggressive angle said that the United States was a ship going somewhere in a hurry. When the SS America was completed in 1939, she was a major coup for Gibbs and the ship's owners, United States Lines, but she was ultimately dwarfed by the European liners. United States would be much bigger. As always, military matters guided the ship's design, so in order to function as a troop ship in wartime, United States would have to squeeze through the Panama Canal, a feat which neither Queen Mary nor Queen Elizabeth could accomplish. This limited United States' beam and overall size, but this wasn't a problem, because Gibbs and his team recognised that bigger did not necessarily mean better. United States would be far bigger than SS America, but smaller than the Queen Mary. Referring to the likes of Queen Mary and Normandy, Gibbs said, perhaps a little bit harshly, that these larger displacement ships are consistent only with the past and the limitations of obsolescent engineering, and not with the general principle that higher speed with economy of fuel necessitates lightweight. United States would be a speed demon, to be sure, but she would not be breaking any size records. To reduce drag and enhance United States' speed, Gibbs also gave his ship a very shallow draft. Just 31 feet of the ship's hull would be below the waterline. Compare that with the America, which was about 50% smaller overall than the United States, but whose draft was a whopping 33 feet. Queen Mary, which was about 34% bigger than the United States, had a monstrous 38-foot draft. A bigger draft helps make a ship more stable, so United States had to be designed with the lowest center of gravity of any liner afloat. To even accomplish this required an ultra-lightweight superstructure, and to this end, Gibbs employed the use of aluminium on almost everything structural above the hull, from the lifeboats and their davits to the enormous funnels and the deck ventilators. It was the largest use of aluminium in a single construction project up until that time. Its use meant that there would also be no need for expansion joints, a common feature found on older liners, which were prone to creaking, cracking, and leaking. So Gibbs and his team had designed a long, lean hull that could slice through the ocean like a knife in any kind of weather. An ocean liner can't just slow down when it's stormy, it needs to batter its way through, and United States was designed to do just this. With the hull design sorted, Gibbs and his team went on to look at the second big factor that would be behind United States' great speed, which would go on to become a state secret, guarded carefully by the Navy for decades. To understand this, we need to go and look below the waterline. The United States would need a monstrous propulsion system, and turbine engines seem the obvious choice. Among hundreds of other ships, they had driven Queen Mary at enormous speed during her Blue Ribbon winning voyages. But United States' engines would be more powerful, much more powerful. But here, Gibbs had a problem. How do you fit giant turbine engines in the leanest, narrowest hull of any ocean liner at sea? For this, Gibbs had an ace up his sleeve. After years of wartime experience, developing some of the most advanced, fast battleships and destroyers afloat, American turbines were simply smaller and more powerful than their British or European pre-war counterparts. On this top-down view, you can see a slice of Queen Mary's hull at about the engine room, and you can very clearly see a traditional engine and boiler room arrangement. But here, taken from a similar spot on the United States' hull, it's very clear that her machinery takes up far less space, and the split engine room design is very apparent. Because of this arrangement, unlike the SS America, both of United States' funnels were fully functional, with huge uptakes removing smoke from both the forward and aft boiler rooms. While Queen Mary's engines output 158,000 horsepower at full steam, United States could manage 240,000 shaft horsepower using steam superheated to 850 degrees Fahrenheit. That's 450 degrees Celsius. And if a crack or leak developed in the steam lines, anybody standing nearby would be instantly and horrifically scalded. It was a high-risk, high-reward type scenario. At full power, United States turbines would be turning at 5,800 revolutions per minute. It was then down to her double reduction gears to channel this enormous brute power and slow it right down. First to 3,200 revolutions per minute, and finally 180 for the propeller shafts. That was a reduction ratio of 30 to 1, and any gears less solidly built would have fractured or sheared under the enormous strain of 200 tons of thrust on each propeller shaft. Speaking of propellers, here lies the final secret to United States speed. The ship's enormous 18-foot diameter manganese bronze propellers were a work of art unto themselves, and their conception and design had been left in the hands of a promising young engineer whom Gibbs had handpicked himself. Her name was Elaine Kaplan. Now, I don't need to tell you that the 1950s were a pretty tough time to be a lady, and virtually all professional fields, especially engineering, were staffed entirely by men. So it's pretty remarkable that Kaplan's sheer engineering prowess and ability had earned Gibbs's trust and begrudging respect. Leading her team, Kaplan developed a set of four very sleek and aggressively swept screws. Initially, she had intended for the liner to have two pairs of four-bladed propellers, but then disaster struck. At testing, the team discovered that United States would suffer badly from vibration and cavitation when at speed. Cavitation is a phenomenon where a propeller, if incorrectly shaped and designed, is driving through the water at force, creating negative pressure as it spins. This can disrupt flow over the propeller and create bubbles on the surface, which results in vibration and a loss of thrust. Those tiny little gas bubbles can even slowly eat away at the bronze propeller itself, leaving permanent pitting and damage. Many turbine-driven liners had fallen victim to this, from the Lusitania to Normandy, and dozens of propeller redesigns and endless testing had hardly rectified the issue. Elaine Kaplan now faced the same problems. Despite altering the pitch or angle of the ship's propeller blades, the result was the same, and the United States would vibrate unacceptably. Kaplan and her team now went back to the drawing board and turned to some lessons learned from the Second World War. They found a solution which had been used on ships like the Iowa-class battleships of the US Navy. This novel arrangement made use of mismatched propellers, the outboard forward set having four blades, and the inboard after set having five. The extra blade on the inboard set of propellers meant that they would better churn through the water already disturbed and shaken up by the set of propellers ahead of them. Cavitation wasn't totally eliminated from the ship. Today you can see slight damage to the propeller blades caused by those gas bubbles. But the clever design solution meant United States would have a cracking top speed and the effects of vibration would be barely noticeable. The stern section was shrouded in secrecy by the Navy, and the publishing of photographs was forbidden. The United States was completed in 1952, the combined result of 7 years of careful planning and design. On her sea trials, Gibbs and the team held their breath as she worked up to full speed, engines turning at full steam, and even in a near gale, the huge ship hit 38 knots. It was a total triumph. The United States exceeded initial proposals and achieved the fastest speed hit by any ocean liner before or since. This combination of engineering know-how and the borrowing of lessons from older designs and ships resulted in a ship whose speed was the stuff of legends. She would go on to have a long and successful career, carrying 4 US presidents, dozens of celebrities and starlets, and thousands of travelers from holidaymakers to immigrants across the Atlantic. She stole the blue ribbon from Queen Mary on her maiden voyage, and she keeps it to this day. She was Gibbs' pride and joy, America's flagship. She was the fastest ocean liner of all time. Ladies and gentlemen, it's your friend Mike Brady from Oceanliner Designs. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, let me know what you thought in the comments section, and please feel very welcome to subscribe to my channel. It'd be great to have you aboard. This video was brought to you by the patrons of Oceanliner Designs. Please feel free to join the crew on my Patreon. As always, stay safe, stay happy, and I'll see you again next time.